This is the journey of privacy and its quest to be included as a fundamental right. Long ago, when the Constitution was being proposed, privacy was supposed to be a part of it. But in the actual Constituent Assembly debates, while other fundamental rights were included, privacy was tragically left out. In order to become a fundamental right and be rightfully included in the Constitution, privacy would have to fight a series of legal battles. The fate of privacy was in the hands of the Supreme Court and the citizens who chose to move the courts. The first battle for privacy was for protection against state excesses, surveillance, search and seizure. In 1954, the decision of the Supreme Court in the M.P. Sharma case narrowly interpreted the Constitution and did not recognize privacy as a fundamental right. In 1962, judges in the Kharak Singh case delivered a minority opinion that observed that privacy fell under the larger umbrella of the right to life. It was held that it was a facet of personal liberty and freedom of movement. This started a very important conversation. Finally, in 1975, the Supreme Court's verdict in the Govind versus State of MP confirmed the right to privacy and its existence as a part of guarantees under Part 3 of the Constitution, but was subject to reasonable restrictions. However, the legislature was the only authority with the right to draft laws. So, in the absence of legislative enactment or any written mention of the right, a case-to-case basis was the only way to go. Next, there was an attempt to include privacy in the Constitution as an extension of fundamental rights. Instances of advanced means of surveillance like phone tapping and interception were seen as the curtailment of the right to speech. The ruling in the Menaka Gandhi case of 1978 expanded the scope of Article 21, which grants right to life under the Constitution. This allowed for interpreting more rights for individuals against the state. In the Rajagopal case in 1994, a deeper analysis of the right to privacy was undertaken. It was decided that privacy not only falls under Part 3 of the Constitution, but also provides a basis for an actionable claim. In 4 years' time, the PUCL case of 1998 studied the relationship between privacy and communications. It was a significant victory in many ways, leading to legislative action and guidelines for intercepting communication. But privacy still had a long way to go. From defining contours of bodily and mental privacy to protecting private information, many things were still left to be decided upon. This became particularly important in an era of novel means of data collection and other serious threats to privacy. In the Selvi case of 2009, the Supreme Court upheld the right to bodily and mental privacy, extending it to right against self-incrimination under Article 20, Subclause 3, in context of compulsory administration of invasive technologies like narco-analysis and Baptist. As the world became more digitized, the questions of informational privacy and the need to protect it for the benefit of individuals became more pertinent and pressing. In the 2014 UIDAI case, the court focused on informational privacy with the issue of compulsory linkage of Aadhaar cards that could risk private and digital information. In a landmark judgment of the Puttaswamy case of 2017, privacy was finally held as a fundamental right under Part 3, sheltered under Article 21. Now, privacy is a constitutionally protected right which emerges from Article 21 of the Constitution. This is not an absolute right, but any restriction must meet the requirements of legality, necessity, and proportionality. Informational privacy is now an important facet of the right to privacy, and the government is expected to come out with a data protection law in the near future. Although privacy has collected many protections and is still vulnerable in several places, today, privacy is a fundamental right. In the years to come, this right will form the basis for carving various civil rights.